morning, welcome to the service. Welcome to any visitors that are with us today. And if you'd like to sign the visitor's book, it's in the vestibule and the table as you go out of the church, that'd be lovely. Thank you to Liz Clark, who's preaching today, and Alice Maxwell, who's playing the organ. And there'll also be teas and coffees in the hall after the service if you'd like to join us there for further fellowship. This afternoon, Arran Church of Scotland Guild extends a warm invitation to all to the dedication service in St. Wolliers Church at 12 noon today, and the next meeting in the church hall is 2 p.m. on Tuesday the 19th of September, which the speaker's theme will be Going Forward. There will be a service of union here in Brodick Church on the first Sunday of October, which is the first, joining the North and South Linkages. It is with sadness I announce the death of Grace Sellers this week, a faithful member here in Brodick. And here I go with a long letter. Bear with me. Notice is hereby given that in view of the vacancy in this congregation of the Isle of Arran, Church of Scotland, the Kirk Session is about to make up an electoral roll or register. This register is a list of those who will be eligible to vote when the time comes to elect a nominating committee and subsequently the election of a new minister. If your name is currently on the communion roll, then you will automatically be placed on the electoral register. You need take no further action. If you're a regular worshipper here, but are still a member of another congregation and you wish to participate in this election of minister to the congregation of the Isle of Arran Church of Scotland, then you should arrange to hand in the session clerk a valid certificate of transference before the Kirk Session meets. If you're a regular worshipper here and not a member of this or any other congregation, then the Kirk Session can add your name to electoral register as an adherent. If you wish the Kirk Session to consider this, you should obtain a form from the session clerk, Mrs. Shane McLeod, and complete it and return to her before the Kirk Session meets. I actually have some of these forms as well, so you can ask me for a form. The Kirk Session will meet in the church hall in Brodick on Saturday the 7th day of October at 11 a.m. to make up this register. Thank you.
Thank you, Shona. Good morning, everyone. In Romans, we can read, with unflagging zeal, aglow with the Spirit, serve the Lord. We begin by singing number 694, Brother, Sister, Let Me Serve You, 694.
Thank you.
come together in prayer now. Let us pray. Lord God, we turn to you now, to this special space we come, opening our hearts and minds, rejoicing in all that you are to us, expectant in all that you will give to us, receptive to the wisdom we will receive. Guide us to leave at your door our outward confidence and our inward weakness. Enable us not to doubt that you value our presence here and now. Open us to accept our faults and faithlessness and be prepared to be made clean again so that we may praise you, not as a duty to be done, but as a joy and a delight to sing out the wonders of your might, the love you hold out to us, and the power of the Holy Spirit. We confess our sin and weakness before you today, the faults of pride and arrogance that keep us from the acceptance of the free grace you offer each believer who leaves self behind and enters faith wholeheartedly before you. The faults of sloth and lack of focus that have us uninspired and lacking in effectiveness in our witness to the God in our midst and his search for more to love and know him. All the little things that taint the presence of Jesus in our midst and keep us from love of neighbor, these and all the other faults you see in us, we confess. Hear us as we voice the names of those to whom we need to be reconciled, to be truly on the path of Christ our Lord, in whose name we offer this confession of our heart in a moment of silence. God of love, your Son gave us a new commandment, that we should love one another, even as you love us, the unworthy and the wandering. Give us a mind forgetful of past ill will, and a heart to love one another, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Saviour, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, Amen.
First reading this morning is from the Old Testament, and you can find it on page 466 of the Pew Bible, 466, and we're reading Psalm 30. I shall exalt you, Lord. You have lifted me up, and have not let my enemies be jubilant over me. Lord, my God, I cried to you, and you healed me. You have brought me up, Lord, from Sheol, and saved my life as I was sinking into the abyss. Sing a psalm to the Lord, all you his loyal servants. Give thanks to his holy name. In his anger is distress. In his favor there is life. Tears may linger at nightfall, but rejoicing comes in the morning. I felt secure and said, I can never be shaken. Lord, by your favor you made my mountain strong. When you hid your face, I was struck with dismay. To you, Lord, I called and pleaded with you for mercy. is there in my death, in my going down to the pit? Can the dust trace you? Can it proclaim your truth? Hear, Lord, and be gracious to me. Lord, be my helper. You have turned my laments into dancing. You have stripped off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy, that I may sing psalms to you without ceasing. Lord my God, I shall praise you forever. Here ends the first reading. The next reading is from the New Testament, and you can find it on page 60 in the Pew Bible, page 60, and it's Luke chapter 10. And we're reading verses 1 to 20. After this, the Lord appointed a further 72 and sent them on ahead in pairs to every town and place he himself intended to visit. He said to them, "The crop is heavy, but the laborers are few. Ask the owner, therefore, to send laborers to bring in the harvest. Be on your way. I am sending you like lambs among wolves. Carry no purse or pack, and travel barefoot. Exchange no greetings on the road. When you go into a house, let your first words be, 'Peace to this house.' If there is a man of peace there, your peace will rest on him. If not, it will return to you. Stay in that house, sharing their food and drink, for the worker deserves his pay. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and you are made welcome, eat the food provided for you. Heal the sick and say, 'The kingdom of God has come upon you.' But when you enter a town and you are not made welcome, go out into streets and say, 'The very dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off to your shame.' Only take note of this: the kingdom of God has come. I tell you, on the day of judgment, the fate of Sodom will be more bearable than the fate of that town. Alas for you, Chorazin, alas for you, Bethsaida. If the miracles performed in you had taken place in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon at the judgment than for you. As for Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? No, you will be brought down to Hades. Whoever listens to you, listens to me. Whoever rejects you, rejects me. And whoever rejects me, rejects the one who sent me." The 72 came back jubilant. "In your name, Lord," they said, "even the demons submit to us." He replied, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven, and I have given you the power to tread underfoot snakes and scorpions and all the forces of the enemy. Nothing will ever harm you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but that your names are enrolled in heaven." Amen. The Lord bless to us these readings from his holy word.
Thank you, Gina. We sing again, number 645. "I am not ashamed to own my Lord." 645.
Thank you.
chores to do around the house. I'm sure you all had the same experience, and sometimes we were not happy about what we'd been given to do and could be quite resentful about the chore that we really didn't want to do. But doing chores around the house helped us to learn what to do when we would live on our own as adults. And it is true, is it not, that once an adult there are even more chores to do. But our parents knew that if we didn't learn how to take care of ourselves or our belongings and the place we lived, then we would have a lot harder time learning those things when we were older and living by ourselves. And so they started to teach us those things at an early age by having us to do little jobs around the house. I bring this up because in today's scripture, we see Jesus giving his disciples some chores to do. And as he's giving them chores, he's giving them for the same reasons our parents gave us chores, so that they'll know how to do the things Jesus thinks is important once they're out in the world without him. The chores Jesus gave his disciples are a bit different to the chores that we were given, though. They were to go out among the people. They were to teach people that the kingdom of God is near. They were to share God's peace with the households who welcomed them. They were to eat whatever was given to them. And they were to cure the sick. And notice that the disciples were excited that they were able to do the chores that Jesus gave them, rather than resentful as sometimes we were. And one of the reasons they were excited was because they were seeing that they could do what their teacher Jesus did, even if Jesus wasn't physically with them. And today's story reminds us, in the same way the disciples learned to do what Jesus did, so can we. We too can learn from Jesus how to pay attention to God and invite God into our lives. And then, just like the disciples in today's story, we too can share what we've learned about God, as well as share God's peace and healing love with the people around us. We sing again, number 557. O love that will not let me go. 557.
Thank you.
more in prayer, as we offer our prayers of thanksgiving and for others. Let us pray. God of power and might, Christ of the way and the cross, Spirit of truth and light, we offer our thanksgiving for the healing power of faith and for the wholeness of being Christ has brought to us. We offer our thanksgiving for the promise of the kingdom, the presence of the kingdom, the signs of the kingdom in our lives. We offer our thanksgiving for the witness of the apostles, of the saints, and of the neighbor beside us to your love and calling to faith. We offer our thanksgiving for the signs of hope in darkness, for the promise and the presence of abundant life and the nurture of Mother Church. From the dawn of time to the end of time, from the dawn of our birth to the ending of our days, you are the eternal three in one. You are our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, glorified forever. Now we offer our prayers for others. Loving God, you care for all of your children. You know each one and hear each prayer. You know each house and see each need. Give peace and wholeness to those in need this day, and bring into your kingdom all who long for a better life. Bring meaning to those who walk this world searching for your light. Bless your church here and everywhere. Energize our witness and remind us of that great sending out into the highways and byways of a world starved for good news stories, in need of our story of a Redeemer waiting with open arms to receive the lost. Inspire all with love for your house, zeal in your service, and joy in the well-being of your kingdom. Bless your servant, Charles, our King. Govern the hearts and minds of the King's ministers and counselors, that they may fulfill their service for the welfare of the people and the glory of your name. Where there is discord, we pray for harmony. Where there is warfare, we pray for the safety of military and civilian. Where there is breakdown in relations, we pray for reconciliation in the name of the Prince of Peace. Bless with your comfort all those who are in trouble or pain. Heal those who are sick, support those who are dying. Console those who mourn. Supply the wants of those who are in need, and be near to those whom we know personally. Bless our homes, that love and joy may dwell there, and keep those who are absent from us within the protection of your love. We ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. We sing again, number 251, I the Lord of Sea and Sky, 251.
Thank you.
with a search for a new minister for a parish. We have been unable to find a suitable candidate for this congregation, though we have one promising prospect. We have followed up the recommendations from church members with interviews or calling for at least 3 references. This is a confidential report on the prospective candidates. Adam, a good man, but has problems with his wife and children. He and his wife have been known to walk around outside without wearing clothes. Noah, former pastorate of 120 years with no converts, prone to unrealistic building projects. Abraham, reference reported that he once offered to share his wife with another man. Joseph, big thinker, but brags, believes in dream interpretation, and has a prison record. Moses, modest and meek man, but a poor communicator, stutters, known to lose his temper and act rashly, left an earlier position under a murder charge. David, the most promising leader of all, very musical. We discovered he had an affair with his neighbor's wife. Solomon, great preacher, but our man wouldn't hold all his wives and children, has grandiose tastes. Elijah, prone to depression, collapses under pressure. Hosea, a tender, loving pastor, but his wife is somewhat disreputable. Deborah, pushy female. Jeremiah, emotionally unstable, alarmist, negative, always lamenting things. Isaiah, claims to have seen angels, has trouble with his language. Jonah, refused God's call until he was forced to obey when he was swallowed by a fish. He said the fish spat him out on the shore. We hung up. Amos, backward and unpolished, would only fit in a poor rural congregation. John, says he is a Baptist but doesn't dress like one. He has slept outdoors for months on end and eats a weird diet. Doesn't work well with others. Paul, powerful CEO type and fascinating preacher. Short on tact, so long-winded he's been known to preach all night. And Judas, his references are solid, a steady plodder, and a good money manager, conservative and well connected with the community and religious leaders. This is the candidate we would recommend to this congregation. I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did when I read it. We have just taken a walk through the Bible and heard the kinds of people God called to be his prophets and apostles. God calls us all to follow as his disciples, and it is encouraging to know that he doesn't expect us to be any more than ordinary, imperfect human beings. Today's passage is about Jesus sending out 70, or in some versions, 72 of his followers on a missionary journey to share his message and heal the sick. And these were not the inner circle, the 12. They were a wider group who may or may not have had the same sort of intimate contact with him that the 12 enjoyed. But he had a message he wanted to communicate to the world, and he had a sense that time was short. conflict with the authorities had already begun, and he could already see the shadow of the cross looming over his future. So he sent out this group to prepare the way for him in all the towns and villages he was planning to visit. Nowadays, we Presbyterians tend not to be too comfortable with the thought of being sent out to share the Christian message with people who are not Christians. We tend to say things like, some people talk about their faith, I just live mine out and let people draw their own conclusions. It sounds very spiritual and respectful, and of course we're called to live our faith out. And if we don't put it into practice, if we don't live lives that remind people of Jesus, in other words, the chances are that we won't get very far in trying to talk to people about the gospel message. But we should not draw from this conclusion that we don't need to talk about our faith at all. After all, the early Christians didn't just invite the world around them to watch while they silently lived out the teachings of Jesus. At the beginning of the Gospels, Jesus went into Galilee with a message to proclaim. He proclaimed it and invited people to become his followers. At the end of the Gospels, he sent those followers out into all the world to share the message with others. And in between those two bookends, he was teaching them how to live it out and how to share it. But as we read this Gospel passage today, some of the things we find in it don't apply so readily to our situation. Jesus was sending out 70 mission volunteers on a project that would require them to leave their homes and families for a good while and give their whole time to the work of sharing the gospel. But most of us are not on such a trip. Our witness is taking place in the context of our normal, everyday lives. Sometimes at work, amongst our friends and families, and in social gatherings. So there are some differences between our situation and that of those early disciples. But it doesn't mean that the passage has nothing to say to us. And I want to suggest four connections that we can make between the message of this gospel reading and our own call to be witnesses today. Firstly, Jesus is quite clear that people are hungry for this message. In verse 2, Jesus says, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." He sees the world like a field of wheat, full grown and ready to be harvested for the kingdom of God. In other words, there are plenty of people out there who are hungry for the very message the missionaries are bringing. All they have to do is find those people and share the message with them. Many people today seem to be skeptical about this idea. There seems to be a great deal of apathy out there towards Christianity and the Christian church. And in some quarters, the apathy is turned into determined opposition, with the growing popularity of new atheists like Stephen Hawking and Philip Pullman and their message that religion poisons everything. So is it really true that the fields are ripe for harvest, or did that just apply in the time of Jesus? Well, I think there is definitely apathy and opposition. But a great deal of it is directed at the institutional church, not at Jesus and his message. Indeed, there has been an explosion of interest in spirituality in the last decade or so. And if you have had a genuine experience of God, and if that experience is helping you to make sense of your life and live accordingly, many people are more than ready to hear about it. So the harvest is still plentiful, but as Jesus said, the laborers are few. So he says, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out more laborers. But then, perhaps with a twinkle in his eye, he turns to these 70 and says, go on your way. So they're not only to pray to God to send out more messengers, they are to be the messengers, the answer to their own prayers. And actually the same applies to you and me today. The second connection. Jesus sends us out in vulnerability and weakness, not in superiority and power. He says in verse 3, go on your way. See, I am sending you out like lambs into the midst of wolves. And he also tells them to carry no purse, no bag, no sandals, to accept hospitality from people on the way, and to eat whatever is set before them. Throughout our Christian history, we haven't been very careful about following the spirit of these instructions. In the early years, of course, that's exactly how Christian missionaries went out. They had no worldly power, no powerful organization to back them up, no imperial armies to protect them. They walked the roads of the Roman Empire in danger of their lives from mob violence and Roman magistrates. And they were commanded by Jesus not to retaliate, but to love their enemies and pray for those who persecuted them. But after Christianity became the official religion of the Roman Empire in the 4th century AD, the picture changed. Very quickly, the pagans became beyond the pale. And by the time we get to the 14th and 15th centuries, we have the spectacle of military and political power and missionary effort going hand in hand. For example, the Spanish conquistadores going to South America, offering the local tribes the choice of baptism or death. And we still have missionaries going to foreign countries in great wealth, provided by the people back home, able to dole out all kinds of goodies in order to get a hearing for their message. If we are to be effective in our mission today, we have to look more like Jesus. And this means vulnerability. Jesus came not in power, but in weakness. He wasn't interested in the love of power, but rather in the power of love. And he paid the price for that vulnerability when he went to the cross. But still, he calls us to take up our cross and follow him. And thirdly, we see the message that the disciples are told to proclaim in two places in this passage. First, in verse 5, Jesus says, whatever house you enter, first say, peace to this house. Then in verse 9, the disciples are told, cure the sick who are there and say to them, the kingdom of God has come near to you. So we go out to share the message of God's peaceable kingdom. Jewish listeners who knew their scriptures would have been reminded of Old Testament prophecies of the lion lying down with the lamb, people beating their swords into plowshares, and the world streaming to Mount Zion to hear the teachings of Israel's God. The Christian message is the same today, that the whole world has chosen to be estranged from God, rejecting his ways and choosing to worship false gods and live a self-centered life instead. But God wants us to be reconciled to him, and he's not interested in punishing us for our sins. When the world rejected him, he did not reject us back. In a sense, He rejected our rejection. And this God is at this very minute at work in the world, healing the sick and transforming people's lives, helping those who find peace with him also to live in peace with one another, so that the world is changed by the power of his love. And one more thing. This is not just about humans talking to humans. There is a spiritual struggle going on too. After the 70 came back enthused about how well their mission had gone, Jesus said to them, "I watched Satan fall from heaven like a flash of lightning." In other words, when the disciples saw people turning to God in response to their message, Jesus saw more. He saw the advancement of the kingdom of God and the defeat of the kingdom of evil. So there's a spiritual struggle going on, and you and I are part of it. And no wonder Jesus speaks with such urgency when he sends out his 70 missionaries. This isn't a tea party he's starting here, it's a campaign in the struggle to set the world free from evil. And finally, Jesus goes on to tell his 70 disciples, "Behold, I have given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall hurt you. Nevertheless, do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." In other words, what I've given to do you in my name, the work I've given you to do, that's all well and good. But don't lose sight of the bigger picture. You have something even greater to rejoice over. It is the joy that your names have been written in heaven. So this is what Jesus would have us rejoice in as the main thing. It's fine that we can do some work in the kingdom and get things done for the church. That's great. But even greater, far greater, is what God has given us in Jesus Christ. Our sins have been forgiven. Our redemption has been purchased. Our salvation has been won. Our resurrection from the dead and our eternal life are secure. And notice, these are all things that we did not do. God did them for us. So, ask not what you can do for God. Ask what God can do for you. That is faith. We should rejoice over how God blesses the work he's given us to do. But the big joy, the one indispensable, unchangeable, eternal joy we have is this. Rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Let's take a moment now to dedicate our offerings. Let us pray. Gracious God, accept these gifts and with them our lives to be used in your service. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our closing hymn is 739, The Church's One Foundation, 739. We go nowhere by accident. Wherever we go, God is sending us there. Wherever we are, God has put us there. God has a purpose in us being right where we are. Christ, who indwells us by the power of his Spirit, wants to do something in and through us. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever.